Look out. Let's go down New Orleans way. Mr. Antoine Fats Domino.
I found my thrill on Blueberry Hill.
New Orleans gave birth to many of the first rhythm and blues records that crossed over to a large white audience. Fats Domino sold over 30 million records during the 1950s alone, working here at the edge of the French Quarter in tiny J&M Studio. The studio was run by an Italian who grew up with black music, although the New Orleans of his youth was officially segregated.
I lived in what was called a mixed neighborhood because, you know, the white and black families lived cheek by jowl practically in the neighborhood. But my father had two bars side by side. One was a white bar and one was a black bar because that's the way the law was. And two jukeboxes with two kind of different sets of music. But the people from each side played the other side because, strangely enough, a lot of black people played country music that they liked. And of course, white guys played a lot of blues and rhythm and blues. I'm walking, hear the need,
I'm talking, you and me. Fats Domino's music combined country with rhythm and blues and caught the ear of New Orleans writer-producer-arranger Dave Bartholomew in 1949.
Fats has a lot of country and western in his voice. You know, like for most people might say, well, look, walking to New Orleans, he will not do that. He just say, I'm walking to New Orleans, walking to New Orleans, those type of things. You understand? With that twine with it.
The beat just flowed along, and, you know, it wasn't a complicated thing at all.
And his material was something that you heard once, and you could sing it right away. Not maybe remember the lyrics, but you hummed the melody, would just stuck right with you, because it was so simple.
And that's what get the people, and what they start doing is digging down in their pocket to pay for that record. Thank you. We're aboard.
You caught a beast deal. Fats Domino offered white kids an easy first step into the world of black music. He was completely non-threatening, which could never be said of a young singer from Georgia, who is about to rattle Cosmo Matassa's walls with the force of a hurricane off the Gulf of Mexico.
Little Richard was a total extrovert. He really wanted to be the very best. And if you talk to him, and even till today, he'll tell you he's the best.
Hi, I'm Little Richard, baby. I'm the innovator, I'm the emancipator, I'm the originator, I'm the architect of rock and roll. Don't you forget it. This is me, nobody but me. Ain't nothing like me nowhere. Oh, this is me here, Little Richard, baby, the innovator, the architect. Woo!
When I first met Little Richard, it was incredible. I was in Augusta, Georgia, and Richard came over with all this makeup and this loud suit. I can't remember what the color it was. He was a young man, you know. I was standing by my car, and he said, I want a car just like that. I want to get me a car just like that. I want to get out of Georgia, blah, blah, blah.
Georgia was always too subdued for young Richard Penniman. He was born in Macon in 1932. And lived with 11 brothers and sisters in a poor black neighborhood by the railroad tracks.
The train would shake the house that was in front of the track. Everybody would get out of the bed because the train shook the house because they couldn't sleep. And the train would say, chucka, 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 chucka. And it was, to me, it was a rhythm. To me, it was just like a song, you know, and it had this thing to it, to me.
Of the railroad helped shape Little Richard's music. So did listening to the elders in his neighborhood church.
There wasn't no piano and no organ or nothing. You know, they would stomp their feet. Everybody would just stomp their feet. You know, everybody would be rocking. No music, everybody. I'm a bossy, you know, and merely to save myself. You know, everybody, you know, that was that old thing. And now, wasn't no piano beating, and wasn't no organ playing. It was just people's old folks stomping their feet and moaning and groaning.
Lucy!
Lucille was recorded in 1957, but Little Richard's show business career had begun a decade earlier when he left Macon to join a traveling circus.
I went with Sugarfoot Sam from Alabama. Then I went with L.J. Heath show. I just started jumping from show to show. And then I started listening to Boogie Woogies. I started listening to this. Got off a little bit there, but that's it. That's that old boogie woogie. Then I took the boogie woogie and I mixed it with this. Ladies and gentlemen, good evening. I'm glad to be here. I'm talking about fame. So, Miss Artru, you're now finna hear Little Richard and his upsetters. All right, boys, get baby upset.
In the early 50s, Little Richard began to make a name for himself around the South with black audiences, in clubs like New Orleans' Do Drop In, where his act was staged between exotic dancers and female impersonators. Mostly, he sang the blues. Then in September 1955, at the suggestion of Lloyd Price, an independent company called Specialty Records brought Little Richard to New Orleans to record in Cosmo Matassa's studio.
We had finished the session in the studio, and they wanted me to sound like Ray Charles and B.B. King, but I was tired of that. You know, being young and a teenager, I wanted to sound different. Me and the young kids, we was tired of all that slow music. We wanted the boogie. You know, same as when rap music came in today, the kids got tired of what's going on. They wanted something different. They wanted something from their generation. You know, so what I did, I started singing Tutti Frutti loud as I can. Wop, bop, loom, bop, lop, bam, boom, woo, just screaming. And people say, oh, he's going crazy.
Tutti Frutti, oh, Rudy. Tutti Frutti, oh, Rudy. Tutti Frutti, oh, Rudy.
Richard was so hot. Now, if you went into town behind Richard, say Indianapolis, Indiana, you had to wait 2 months if he was there, 3 months, because he would sweep the whole town clean. Everybody went to see Little Richard. He was so excited.
Oh, bah, 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 bah. But the white station wouldn't play black records. It was about four or five black radio stations in the whole country. And the white station wouldn't play me. But I was hitting big. But the white kids had my record, but I wasn't on the radio, you know, and they would hear it from WLAC, called WLAC, and would across the whole country. That's the only thing that helped me. And then they took Pat Boone and threw Pat Boone on me.
Oh, bop, bop, loom, bop, 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 tootie, tootie.
It wasn't something that was done in the beginning when it was rhythm and blues, because it was supposed to be not nice music at all. So you didn't have white artists doing black music. It wasn't acceptable. But when it crossed over to the white audience, and it was a song that did well with blacks and some whites, they said, well, hey, this is a good vehicle. We'll make even more money.
And Pat Boone said, oh, wop, bop, loom, bop, bop, bam, boom. And I still said, oh, wop, bop, loom, bop, bop, bam, boom. And the white kids wanted to hear, wop, bop, loom, bop, bop, bam, boom. Woo, they wanted to hear me. And so they were still bringing me in their house. And they didn't want their mama to know I was in the house. So they put Pat Boone on top of the bed and they put me in the drawer. But I was still in the same house.
Oh, wop, bop, loom, bop, bop, bam, boom.